So that, sorry. Very sorry, ma'am. Sir, just a minute, ma'am, because we have to send this thing to it. Yes, again, yes, I am studying. So let me introduce Dr. Sipanna, sir. And Dr. Sipanna, sir, received the M.Tech and PhD degrees in computer science from ISI Kolkata. She is currently working as an associate professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Patna. She has authored more than 223 papers. Her current research interests include machine learning, information extraction, text mining, bioinformatics, and multi-objective optimization. She is the recipient of the Rasirai Memorial Gold Medal from ISI Kolkata for outstanding performance in M.Tech. She is recipient of the Google India Women in Engineering Award, NASI Young Scientist Platinum Jubilee Award, BARD Award, IEI Young Engineers Award, SORB Women in Excellence Award, and SORB Early Career Research Award. She is also the recipient of DO India Fellowship, Humboldt Research Fellowship, Indo-US Fellowship for Women in STEM, and CNRS Fellowship. She had also received India for You Fellowship of the European Union to work as a postdoctoral research fellow in the University of Trento, Italy, during the period of September 2010 to January 2011. She was also the recipient of EMA Fellowship of the European Union to work as a postdoc in Heidelberg University, Germany, during the period of September 2009 to June 2010. She had visited University of Caen, France, University of Mainz, Germany, University of Kyoto, Japan, as a visiting scientist. She also won the Best Paper Award in Clinical NLP Workshop of Pooling 2016 and IEEE IndyCon 2015. So this is all about introduction of the Dr. Sipanna sir. So now, ma'am, session is yours. Now you can start.
Thank you for the nice introduction and good morning to all the participants. So today I will be mainly delivering a talk on dialogue management systems. So, you know, chatbot is a recent application of natural language processing. In order to build chatbot, we have to apply different natural language processing modules. So in this talk, we will see how to build a particular chatbot, what are the different components of a chatbot, and how can we make efficient chatbot. So as I am already introduced, so I am currently associate professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Patna, and I am also associate in research and development of IIT Patna. So these are my email addresses and this is my web page. So all the publications of mine are listed in my web page. So you can visit my web page in it to basically download the papers. And if you will be having any doubt further, you can write to me. So this would be basically the overview of my talk. So I will first introduce what do we mean by dialogue. Like, you know, chatbot means basically dialogues between the agent and the user. So what do we mean by a dialogue? What is a dialogue system? Then there are different components of a dialogue system. So that we will introduce. There is natural language understanding, dialogue management, natural language generation. So so these different modules of the dialogue system we'll discuss, and then individual modules we will show you some recent works of the individual modules. So how to build a dialogue act classification, or how to build a dialogue management strategy, and how can we enable the agent to consider the user input in the form of image as well as text. So those multimodal input scenarios we will also discuss. So this is a chatbot. So there is an agent which is a kind of robot, so which is called the chatbot. So chatbot means which can chat with the customers. So this is a kind of a robot, but which can chat with the customers. So suppose the chatbot is saying, hello, how can I help you? Now the customer, the user is saying my computer isn't working. So there will be a series of communications like this, because the bot has to understand what is going wrong. So the bot has to somehow understand what is going wrong, what are the problems associated with the computer, because then only it can help in repairing, it can provide a useful suggestion to the user. So finally, after receiving the suggestions, so you know, the customer can say that great, that solved my problems and thank you, etc. And the customer and the agent can reply anytime. So this way, basically, this is the flow of a conversation. So a user and the agent will keep on chatting each other. Either it could be in the form of a text or it could be in the form of speech. So they used to chat with each other to solve a particular problem. So basically, there is a particular task. So either the task is to book a flight between two cities. Maybe the user is interested in booking flight between two cities, or the user is interested in booking a restaurant or a movie ticket, or maybe it is a customer care representative where the user is facing some problem of his or her computer, and that problem can be solved by the agent. So dialogue means a formal discussion of a topic in speech or writing. This is a connected series of utterances, a text or conversation. Exchange of ideas or opinions on a particular issue with a view to reaching an amicable agreement. So dialogue is basically a connected series of utterances, a text or conversation. Exchange of ideas or opinions on a particular issue with a view to reaching an amicable agreement. So now there are different characteristics of a dialogue, like what is the intention of a dialogue, what is the meaning of a particular utterance, what is the type of a particular utterance, whether a particular utterance is a question or it is an open question or it is a statement or it is an agreement or this is a disagreement or this is a greeting. So there are different types of a dialogue. And given the utterance, you need to classify what is the type of a dialogue, whether it is a question or it is a statement or it is an open question or it is a greeting. So that is basically called the dialogue act classification. Now, given an utterance, what is the intention of the user? So like if the user says, please book a ticket from Bhubaneswar to Kolkata. So that means the user wants to book a ticket. So that is the intention of the user. So from the given utterance, we need to understand what are the intentions of the user. And then once the intentions are understood, now we have to think of how to reply back. How to reply back. So reply. So basically now the agent has to reply the customer. So there are many steps. First, the important information from the user utterance has to be extracted. Useful information means this Bhubaneswar and Patna. So book tickets from Bhubaneswar, book a flight ticket from Bhubaneswar to Patna. Here the important information are the source city and the destination city. And also if the user has mentioned the date, then date and time are two crucial important information which should be extracted from the user utterance. And then these are called the slots. So slots are basically stored in the state space. So there is a state space and slots are stored in the state space. And this state space is basically given as an input to the dialogue manager. So dialogue manager is a reinforcement learning based agent. So this dialogue manager is responsible for mapping the dialogue state to dialogue action. So dialogue manager is basically responsible for mapping the dialogue state to dialogue manager. So it basically maps, given the slots, it basically takes an action. And then this action is basically translated into natural language by using natural language generation module. So you can understand, you see, these are the different components of a dialogue system. So user is saying, which restaurant can I book for two people for today? given the user input, there is this natural language understanding module. So natural language understanding module first tries to identify what is the type of a dialogue. So this is a question. So the dialogue act classification will produce you that this is a type of a question. Now what is the intent? So which restaurant can I book? So it is a basically booking a restaurant. So the intent classification will give you the output that the user is interested in booking a restaurant. Now slots, what are the important information extracted from this utterance? So two people and today. So these are the two important information. So that the user wants to book the restaurant for two people and also for today. So this gives us a slot, slot information. So the slot is the date is equal to today and number of people equal to two. So these two constitutes the state information. So given the intent and the dialogue act and the state information, now the dialogue management component is basically invoked. So dialogue management component is a Markov decision process. It basically takes help of reinforcement learning for the training. So its task is to map the state space to an action. So given a particular set of slots, it basically takes a particular action. So in the state space, we have the slots like date equal to today and number of people equal to two. And this state is basically mapped to an action by the dialogue management component. So this action could be many things. It could be asked, it could be re-asked, it could be greeting, it could be confirmation. So there are many types of actions possible. For example, here, given this, that date and the time and the number of people are known, now the agent will ask for the category of the restaurant. So agent is asking what is the category of the restaurant. And the natural language generation module will translate this answer into a system response. So it will translate the action like ask category into system response. So the agent will ask what type of restaurant are you looking for? So the user has to basically reply the type of the restaurant. So this is the overall dialogue system. So you can understand dialogue system is having several components. One is called the natural language understanding component. So this natural language understanding is basically is important to understand the user input. So it is responsible for extracting relevant information from the user input. So there are three components of natural language understanding: dialogue act classification, intent classification, and slot filling. So dialogue act classification is responsible for the type of the dialogue. Intent classification is responsible for determining the intent of the data of the user, and slot is extracting the useful information. So now we will discuss about a particular work on dialogue act classification. So dialogue act classification means determining the type of a particular dialogue. So we'll see that when the user is discussing or the when there is chatting with the agent, this chat, you know, the either it can be in the form of a text or it can be in the form of a speech. So in terms of speech, there are three different signals. So you have the voice tones, you have the voice signals, you have the facial expressions, you have the text information. So text is basically what the user is saying. That form is basically called the text format. But user's tone is also important. So, you know, by observing the tone only, you can identify whether it is a question or it is a statement. Similarly, facial expressions is very important, because by checking the facial expression, you can understand whether the user is agreeing or the disagreeing. So basically, you know, this in this task, we have considered the different modalities of data. We have considered not only the text data, but also the audio and the video signals to understand the dialogue acts. So, and then we will show that emotion also helps in identifying the dialogue acts. Whether the user's emotion is positive or negative, or user is sad or angry. So depending on that, we can also determine the type of the dialogue. So dialogue act classification to identify the communicative intention of a speaker in a dialogue conversation, classified into a predefined category. So dialogue act classification is the to identify the communicative intention of a speaker in a dialogue conversation, classified into a predefined category. So there are different types of dialogue acts. There are different types of dialogue acts. Like, what kind of experience do you have then with the child care? So this is a question. I think it is really, this is a statement. How about you? This is an open question. That's all right. This is an understanding. So you can understand that different, these are the different types of dialogue acts.
Ma'am, we are not audible.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Audible.
Yes. So primarily the motivation is that in general, why we did this one. In most of the cases, the dialogue act classification was done from the single modality. Like, only the textual modality is used for identifying the type of the dialogue. But in this work, as I mentioned, that we are not only incorporating the textual modality, but we are also incorporating two different other modalities, the facial expressions and the audio signals. Non-verbal features like change of tone or the facial expression can provide useful cues to identify DAs, thus stressing the role of incorporating multimodal inputs into the task. So basically, our task is to identify the dialogue gaps from the multimodal input. And similarly, there is another motivation, that the emotional state of the speaker has a substantial effect in determining the dialogue gaps. So if the user is sad or user is angry, or what is the emotion of the user, that also determines the type of the dialogue. For example, okay, sure, yeah, right, can be considered as agreement or disagreement depending on the multimodal inputs or depending on the emotional state of the user. Mostly in expressive DAs such as greeting, thanking, apologizing, speaker's emotion can assist in recognizing communicative intention. So what we did, we find out that there is no data set available where both the emotional levels and the dialogue acts are present. So basically, we created a new data set. In this data set, there are three modalities, audio, video, and text. And each utterance is basically labeled with its emotion tag as well as with its dialogue act tag. So this data set is called the EmoTida. And also, secondly, we propose a multitask framework. So our assumption is that if we can solve two tasks, emotion recognition and the dialogue act classification simultaneously, then emotion recognition will surely help in solving the dialogue act classification. So basically, you know that we propose a multimodal multitask framework where you know that both two tasks, the emotion recognition and the dialogue act classification are solved simultaneously. So we propose an attention-based neural network for jointly optimizing the DSC and emotion recognition task. Emotion recognition has been treated as an auxiliary task, aiding the primary task, dialogue act classification. We curate a new dataset, multimodal emotion DA, with high quality annotations of DAs, including emotionally aided cues for facilitating research in multimodal DAC, and lead to a Nobel subtask, emotion aware DAC. So now it is a new subtask, which is called the emotion aware DAC. So whether the emotion helps in identifying the dialogue acts. So we established that multitasking and multimodality boosted the identification of DAs compared to the single task and unimodal DAC variants. So basically, you know, we developed a new data set which is called the EMO-TTA. So we first scan the literature and we find out that there is no data set available where the emotion labels and the dialogue act labels are present. So we identified two emotion recognition data sets, IOMOCAP and MAIL. So these two data sets are basically emotion, these two data sets have multimodal inputs and they are emotion labels are already annotated. So we took these two data sets, and these two data sets are conversational data sets. There are multi-party and guided conversations in these two data sets. So what we did, we put the dialogue acts in these two data sets. So there is a tag set, SWBD DAMSL tag set. So this is a very famous tag set for dialogue act classification. So this is consisting of 42 dialogue acts, but we have basically annotated these two data sets with the 12 most commonly occurring tags. So these 12 most commonly occurring tags are greeting, question, answer, statement, opinion, statement, non-opinion, apology, comment, agreement, disagreement, acknowledgement, back channel, and others. To remove the discrepancy in the number of emotion tags for IMOCAP and MAIL dataset, the joy tag of the MAIL dataset was mapped to happy tag of IMOCAP to finally settle on 10 emotion tags from IMOCAP for the EMO-TTA dataset. So this is an example of our dataset. So you can see that EMO-TTA dataset is having total 1,341 dyadic and multi-party conversations, resulting in a total of 19,365 utterances or annotated videos with emotion and DA tags. And each utterance is having three modalities: audio, video, and text. So video captures the facial expressions, audio captures the tone, and text is the what the user is saying. So this is one. These are some examples of the EMO-TTA dataset. Adders don't snap the string. So this is an disagreement. So dialogue act tag is disagreement. Emotion is anger. Well, I just checked out messages and Joshua didn't call. So this is a statement, and the emotion is sad. That's very amusing indeed. So this is again a disagreement, and the emotion is basically anger. Come on, pick up. This is a, you know, comment, and the emotion is basically fear. So you can see in our data set, 48% samples are generated from the IOMOCAP data set, and 52% are taken from the MAIL data set. This is the overall speaker distribution. So there are multiple speakers, and this is the overall speaker distribution. So this is the distribution of DAs and emotion labels across the source data sets. So you can see these are the distribution of emotion labels across the, there are two source data set, IMOCAP and the MAIL. So this is the distribution of emotion labels in the two data sets. And this is the distribution of dialogue act labels across two data sets. So there are MAIL and IMOCAP. This is the distribution of dialogue acts across the data sets. Now, what is the role of emotion? These examples, like, see, well, you know, I appreciate you coming over and talking to me. I mean, it definitely helps. So it is sad, emotion is sad, and this sad basically helps in identifying the dialogue act as acknowledgement. I can't leave it, you caused a hole in my dinghy floor. So here it is, the emotion is anger, and this anger is helping us to identify the decision disagreement. So this example illustrates the importance of having emotion information while deciding the DA open utterance. The presence of emotion in the dataset caters the models with the ability to use additional information while reasoning about DA. So these are the examples which shows that multimodality gives us different forms of information. So they are not consistent, because sometimes they are not consistent with each other. Like fine, they knew tail Roger because he was really looking forward to this. Their text suggests agreement or the opinion, but the audio is commanding tone and video is furious. So you understand that there is this inconsistencies between the different modalities. That's very amusing indeed. Text is agreement, audio is sarcastic tone, video is slight anger. So again, you understand that this is an example where the inconsistencies are there between amongst different modalities. So in both the examples, there exists inconsistency between the modalities, which acts as a strong indicator that multimodal information is also important in providing additional cues for identifying DAs. The availability of complementary information across multiple modalities improves the model's ability to learn discriminatory patterns that are responsible for this complex process. So now this is all about our data set. So as we mentioned, our one past contribution was the development of a data set. So that's why I spent some time in giving you some characteristics of the data set. So you now understood that the data set is having three components. Each sample is having its audio signal, video signal, and the text. And then each sample is basically labeled with two tags. One is the emotion tag, another is the DAC tag. Now about the methodology. So first of all we have to extract features from different modalities. So we have to extract features from the textual modality, then the audio modality, from the video modality. So for the textual features, we have used the GLOBE embedding. So GLOBE is a word embedding. So GLOBE word embedding basically maps the words into its vector representations. And these vector representations are mostly done in the semantic space. So that the meaning of the word is preserved. So basically in the semantic space, if you can see the vectors, the distance between the boy and girl would be very much equal to the distance between the man and the woman. So the semantic similarity is basically preserved in that vector space. So we find out the GLOBE embeddings of the individual words, and then the word embeddings of each word are concatenated to finally obtain the utterance representation. So utterance is nothing but a collection of words. So basically we get the word embeddings, and then we concatenated the word embeddings to generate the utterance embedding. So there is this audio features to elicit features from the audio. OpenSmile and open source software has been used. Features are concatenated together to form a 256 dimensional representation for each window. The final audio representation of each utterance is obtained by concatenating the feature vector for every window. Similarly, for the video is nothing but the collection of images. To elicit the visual features, a full layer of an ImageNet, pretend ResNet 152 image classification model has been used. The visual representation of each utterance is obtained by concatenating the 4096 dimensional vector for every frame. So for the textual modality, there are three LSTMs. One LSTM learns DSC features tuned in accordance with the emotion features. Second LSTM learns features for the ear task regulated by the learning of the D8 features. And third, by LSTM learns private features for the task of DSC not influenced by emotions. Audio and video features are passed through a fully connected layer to learn attention of different variants. We applied three different types of attentions. One is the self attention, intermodal attention, and the inter-task attention. And after application of the attentions, we get the sentence vector representations for individual tasks. So we get a sentence vector representation for dialogue act classification. Similarly, a sentence vector representation of the emotion recognition. Because here in the multitask approach, we aim to solve two tasks, dialogue act and the emotion recognition. So after we obtain the sentence representations for the two tasks, like one sentence representation for the dialogue acts and the other sentence representation for the emotion, we pass them through the fully connected layer to basically finally get the labels. So basically the sentence representations are passed through a fully connected layer to finally get the labels. So these labels are the dialogue acts or the emotion labels. So basically, this is a multitasking approach. So for each utterance, we are generating the dialogue acts and the corresponding emotion labels in the output. So the sentence representation for each of the tasks from the TAs are connected to a fully connected layer, which in turn consists of output neurons for both the tasks. The errors computed from each of these channels are backpropagated jointly to successive prior layers of the module to learn joint features of both the tasks. So we have performed the experiments on this new data set, which is called the EMOTIDA. And this EMOTIDA is basically the collection of two data sets. So basically we performed the experiments separately on the multi-party and dyadic, and also in a combined mode. And we also compared with the single task variants as well as on the single modality. So what will happen if we only use the textual modality or the audio modality or the video modality? Then we took two modalities together, and finally we considered the three modalities together. So what we observed is that audio modality is not performing well. Audio modality is not giving good results. So because maybe the features that we have extracted are not optimal one. We have used the OpenSmile software. So maybe the features extracted are not optimal one. So that's why the audio modality is not giving us the good result. Different modalities improve the unimodal DSC baseline significantly. So you can see that text and the video, this gives us the best result, and we are getting the F score of 68%, and that is much better compared to the single task. So single task is only getting 64%, but when we are associating the emotion recognition with it, we are improving the accuracy, we are improving the appraisal by 4%. So these are the examples. You can see these five instances. So in the five instances, you can see the true labels are given: disagreement, agreement, order, and the apology. And then you can see in most of the cases, multitasking is basically matching with the original label, but the single task is giving us the wrong labels. Then we have also compared different types of attentions: feature level Lally function, hidden state level function, hypothesis level function, and then intermodal attention, inter-task attention. So there are different types of attention vectors that we have used. And then we have also shown that, you know, that when we are using the multitasking, the focus is given on the correct word. So this is the heat map. This heat map shows that during the classification, basically the words which are having the dark color are more are having more importance. So you can see that for in case of single task, focus was given to the wrong words. But when we are solving the multitasking, DSC plus ear, the focus is given to the correct word, like can't, stop. These are the important words now. And you know that in order to identify the dialogue apps, these are only the important words. So this is all about dialogue app classification. So you can understand that we developed a multimodal based approach, which is also multitasking. So in the multitasking framework, we have solved two tasks. One is the dialogue act classification, other is the emotion recognition. And also it is a multimodal approach. So we have considered three modalities together: audio, video, and text. So now, you know, as I mentioned, the dialogue systems are having different components. So one component is called the dialogue management. So dialogue management is basically a Markov decision process, so which maps the state space to an action. So basically, you know, dialogue manager will be discussing about the some dialogue managers now. Up to dialogue act classification, do you have any question?
Any questions from anyone? No, ma'am, you can continue.
Okay.
I think at last, they will ask the question.
Okay, so we will discuss about a hierarchical approach for efficient multi-intent dialogue policy learning. So, you know that, as I mentioned, dialogue manager is a mapping from state to action. Now we'll see that how can we develop a hierarchical dialogue manager for a task-oriented virtual agent. I have mentioned that what do you mean by the task-oriented? So the user has a particular task. User wants to book a flight or user wants to book a restaurant. So these are the tasks involved. And the agent has to basically keep on chatting with the agent has to keep on chatting with the user to basically to solve the particular task. For managing multi-intent conversations using reinforcement learning. So basically our aim is to basically we will be managing multi-intent conversations and using reinforcement learning. So intent captures the main communicative intention of the user utterance. Multi-intent captures more than one intentions present in an user utterance. Like, show me flights and cheapest fare from Pittsburgh to Denver. So this has multiple intents, which are flight and the airfare. So show me flights and cheapest fares from Pittsburgh to Denver. So there are two intents, flight and the airfare. So basically, multi-intent captures more than one intentions present in a user utterance. In general, in normal scenario, each intent will have its own network. So network is basically a deep learning-based network, which is used deep reinforcement learning algorithm for training. So these are called the controller policies. So for each intent, there will be a controller policy, and this controller policy will basically decide how to serve the particular intent. So for example, user wants to buy a ticket, buy a flight ticket. So this flight reservation is an intent, and how to serve this intent, for that there will be a neural network. And this neural network, the inputs are basically the states and the outputs are basically the actions. So, you know, but now what we are doing, we are making the state space common. So the now the slots are basically sharing the state space. There is only one state space which is common between common amongst all the intents. So then what will happen if some intents share some slots, like, you know, the student booking and the flight booking, for example, for the flight inquiry and the flight booking, they have many slots common. So basically, if already those slots are there in the state space, then for the second intent, there is no need to ask again the question, fill up the slots. So the slot is basically common amongst the multiple intents. They are sharing the state space. And then there is a multi-hot encoded representation. So there is an intent classifier. The intent classifier's task is to identify the intent. And accordingly, there will be a multi-hot encoded intent state space. And this multi-hot encoded intent state space will try to invoke the correct controller. Because for each intent, there is an individual controller. So there is an intent meta policy. So this intent meta policy will try to invoke the correct controller policy. And then basically, you know that there is this slots and natural language generation. So slots are important information from the dialogue. And natural language generation is basically mapping the user action to a user utterance. So this is our proposed basically Markov decision process. A generic architecture of Markov decision process is used. It finds its applicability in any domain having n number of intents and n number of slots. So basically, what is the state space now? So state space is having two components. In one part, the one part keeps track of the current intent. So intent is encoded as a multi-hot representation, and the second part is basically the all the slots of all the intents. So you have to find out the all the slots of all the intents, and those are basically stored in the form of a state space. So S1 keeps track of the current intent being served by the VA in the form of one hot encoded vector. This in turn invokes the appropriate RL model corresponding to the intent being served. State S1 represents the top level hierarchy of the DL. And S2 is the for each of the intents. S2 is a couple of variables of the length equals to the number of slots required to be filled up for the particular intent. This state represents the bottom level hierarchy of the DL. These slot variables in turn correspond to confidence values of different slots, which the probability values outputted from the slot module, representing the confidence of the module in predicting different slot actions, slot levels. And then there are many actions. So depending on the state space, the action, and there are different types of actions. So basically, there are 21 unique actions. Ask, re-ask, confirm, salutation, ask. There are different actions, like there are 21 actions. Now, what is the reward model? So basically, you know that there are different reward functions. So first is basically, you know, the what will happen that if suppose the user is performing an action, then there will be some changes in the state space. So the NS represents the new state and the CS represents the current state. So after picking action, you know, some slot, the user will say something, and as a result of that, some slots will be updated. So basically, the new state represents the new slot values and the OCS represents the current state. So this difference into W1 is a multiplier. So we are giving this as a reward function. And we introduce the minus W2. This minus W2 is a penalty. So if the chatbot will repeat the same question multiple times, like if suppose the chatbot is not progressing, it is keep on asking the same question multiple times, then there should be a penalty. So this W2 is introduced to just to give a penalty. So you know, minus W2. So if it will keep on asking the same question, there will be more penalty. So after empirical studies, we experimented with different values of weight factors, and finally we have selected W2 equal to 1 and W1 equal to 8. Now termination condition. So at the end, we expect that all the slot values should be greater than 0.7. We expect that the probability values of all the slots should be greater than 0.7. Now, if the slots are not having probability greater than 0.7, that means there is no success. It was not a successful dialogue. So in that case, basically, you know, there will be a failure. So if the slot values, all the slot values are not greater than 0.7, then the reward is minus W1 into end state minus current state. So what we expect? So we expect that all the state values would be 0.7. So that ideal state is represented by EV. And CS is basically the current state. And we are putting minus because now this is a penalty that the agent is not able to complete the dialogue. And if the condition is satisfied, that means if all the slots are having value greater than 0.7, then that the condition is satisfied. In that case, the reward is W1 into CS. CS is basically the summation of all the slot values. So these are the graphs, learning curves. You can see that for different MDPs, these are the learning curves. So we are average reward versus iterations. We are learning the average reward versus iterations. For flat DL, there is no learning, but for the different MDPs, there is learning. You can see that average reward is keep on increasing and then it becomes saturated. Now, here basically, you know, user often switches between the domains. Like user utterance, show me flights and cheapest fares from Pittsburgh to Denver and also some Chinese restaurant in Denver. So suppose the user wants to, there are two domains involved, the flight domain as well as the restaurant domain. So user wants to book a flight as well as the user wants to book a restaurant in a destination city. So basically if two domains are involved, then in the previous case, our previous model, you will not be able to handle this. Because our previous model is capable of having handle multiple intents, but not for multiple domains. So what will happen if there are multiple domains? So each domain will have its own set of intents. So now, rather than having separate dialogue managers for individual domains, we can have a hierarchical dialogue manager. So this hierarchical dialogue manager can somehow identify the domain and then invoke the corresponding here the task is to develop a dialogue manager's management strategy for multi-domain, multi-intent conversation. So composite task includes multiple domains and each domain is having its multiple intents. So that's why we need a hierarchical dialogue manager. At the top level, there will be domain classifier. Domain classifier will invoke a particular domain policy. Then the domain policy will invoke a particular intent policy, and the particular intent policy will invoke.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking sometimes.
Hello.
Your voice is breaking sometimes in between.
Oh, now
it's okay. Okay.
So basically, we would like to develop a hierarchical policy. So you can see from this figure, we would like to develop a hierarchical policy. So at the top level is the domain policy. So user is giving an utterance, user is uttering an utterance. Then the domain classifier will try to identify domain, whether it is a restaurant domain, or it is a hotel reservation domain, or it is a movie domain. So it will try to identify the domain, and accordingly a particular policy would be invoked. Now each domain is having its own set of intents. So accordingly, a particular intent would be invoked. So if the domain one is invoked, so then there are different intents of the domain one. There are different intents of the domain two. So accordingly, any of the intent would be invoked. And then for each intent, there will be a controller policy. So basically, the corresponding controller policy would be invoked. So this way, basically, it works. It is a hierarchical framework. So first is a domain policy. Then for each domain, there are multiple intents. And for each intent, there is a controller policy. So use of hierarchical reinforcement learning, which is called the options framework, provides a hierarchical framework to decompose complex tasks into multiple subtasks. So analogous to its literal meaning, a top level policy selects subtasks to complete, which is called a domain meta policy. Intermediate level policy selects subtasks to complete, chosen a domain or subtask, which is called the intent meta policy. Low level policies chooses primitive actions to complete the selected subtask. It is called the controller policy. Double deep Q network with priority experience replay is basically employed to train policies at different hierarchies. So now what are the reward functions? So at the top level, the reward is given if the correct domain is selected. And basically state space is the all domains and intents of the system in multi-hot encoded form. And options is to select particular domain at a particular time. So if the correct domain is selected, then there is a reward of W1. Otherwise, there is a penalty of W1. In intent meta policy, the state space is the all intents of the domain and all the slots of the domain. Although basically the slots are nothing but the confidence scores. Options is to select particular intent at a particular time. So it is W1 into ES minus SS. ES is the end state, SS is the starting state in a W1. So basically reward is end state minus starting state into W1. So if the intent is correctly chosen, then there will be reward, otherwise there will be penalty. Penalty would be minus of W1. And for the controller policy, it is very much similar to our previous approaches. So in our previous approach also, controller policy was having different reward. So at each step, after picking up an action, there will be a new state. It will move to a new state. So the difference between the new state and the current state into W1 is the reward. And minus W2 is introduced just to avoid that the agent should not repeat the same action. So just to give a penalty that the agent should not repeat the same action, this minus W2 is introduced. At the terminating time step, subject to a check condition, reward is basically W1 into CS, the current state, the slot, the probability values of all the slots of the current state. And if the condition is false, then it is a penalty of minus W1 into end state minus current state. So this is a three-level hierarchical dialogue manager. So in the top level, this is the domain policy. Then there is this intermediate level intent policy. And third is the low level controller policies. So at the top level, we have to invoke the corresponding with the correct domain policy. Then we have to invoke the corresponding intent policy. And finally, given the intent policy, we have to invoke the low level controller policies.
So basically, you can understand that we basically, you know, that there are three levels. Top level is for the domain, next level is for the intent, and the third level is for the controller. So these are the results. So you can see that if you are having a flat DRL, there is no hierarchical structure at all, then the reward is very low. But with the help of this hierarchical DRL, there is that the reward is basically, you know, reward has increased a lot, and then it becomes saturated. The next speaker is the meta intent restaurant agent and the meta intent flight agent. You can see their reward functions. So you can see in most of the, in all the cases, the hierarchical policy tries to improve the agent's the reward function. So this is an example utterance, like, you know, the user is saying welcome to information, agent is saying welcome to information query system, how can I help you? User is saying show me flights and cheapest fares from Pittsburgh, Denver, and also some Chinese excusing a student in Denver. So basically it is giving so many information, and all the information like, you know, the Pittsburgh, Denver, Chinese cuisine, Denver. So all these are the important information. These are called the slots. Please specify the class of flight. User, I want to travel in economy class. So basically user is asking, agent is asking about the class. Specify the time and date on 4th January at morning. Then agent is asking, what do you want to travel by economy class? User is saying yes. So now user has all the information. User has the source and destination city. User has the date and time. User has the what kind of, what is the economy class or the business class. So all the important information are already with the user. Now it will show you already with the agent. So with this information, the agent can search in the database and then can retrieve some information and then can display that to the user. The flights from Pittsburgh to Denver on 4th January at morning by economy class are XYZ. So now agent is asking round trip or one way fare. User is saying round trip. Agent is giving the cheapest fares of the flight from Pittsburgh to Denver on 4th January at morning. Her economy is $1,000 for Z. Agent is saying, please mention if you have any requirement for budget and ratings of restaurants. User is now basically, you can understand that domain in the initially when user has started the conversation, user has specified two domains. One is basically the flight booking domain, and it is the restaurant domain. So automatically there is a switch. So once it basically starts the, completes the task in the flight domain, it basically switches to the next domain, which is the restaurant. So please, so basically agent is asking, please mention if you have any requirement for budget and ratings of restaurants. User is saying any cheap places having 3-star ratings. Agent is saying, please mention if you require any other amenities. Agent is saying anything that offers a game room. Agent is saying 3-star Chinese students with cheap prices offering a game room at Denver are A, B, C, and D. Now agent is saying, do you need anything else? User is saying, does C restaurant opens before 11 a.m.? Agent is replying, yes, C restaurant remain open from 10 a.m. to 11 p.m. Agent is saying, do you need anything else? User is saying, no, thanks. And agent is saying, thank you for choosing our services. So you can understand that how the switching happens. So switching can happen from domain to domain, or switching can happen from intent to intent. So initially the user was serving the queries of the user in the flight domain, and then it switches to the restaurant domain. Now, what we have done, we have used the transfer learning approach. So you know, in all the domains, it is not possible to have the similar amount of data. So some domains have less amount of data, some domains have more amount of data. So if we can develop a dialog manager for the source domain, can we use the same dialog manager for the destination domain? So basically, this is the task of transfer learning based task oriented dialog policy for multiple domains using hierarchical reinforcement learning. So we develop a multi-domain, multi-intent-based task-oriented dialog system by successfully combining hierarchical deep reinforcement learning and transfer learning paradigms. So to develop a multi-domain, multi-intent-based task-oriented dialog system by successfully combining hierarchical deep reinforcement learning and transfer learning paradigms, it gives GA the capability to handle complex and composite tasks of the user pertaining to multiple domains. So basically the idea is that if the two domains have some shared intents, then what is the point in starting with some random weights in the destination domain? The destination domain should somehow borrow the neural network architecture from the source domain. So basically, you know, finally the controller policies are the neural networks where the inputs are the state space and the outputs are the actions. So each intent is having its own controller policies, and there are suppose two domains, source and the destination. So now the source domain is having many intents, destination domain is having many intents. So there must be a one-to-one mapping from source domain intents to the destination domain intents. So depending on their semantic similarity, like booking a restaurant and the booking for a movie.
Ma'am, not audible.
Hello.
Ma'am, not audible.
Not audible. Hello.
Yes, yes. Now it's okay.
Okay. So the idea is that there are the many domains are somehow semantically similar, like booking a restaurant and booking a movie are quite similar in nature. So can we somehow map the domains which are similar in nature and their corresponding intents? The notion is to exploit or take advantage of the resemblance between a source and a target domain. Like the restaurant and the hotel reservation share considerable amount of overlap data or attributes in terms of slots. Previous works were focused on creating end-to-end virtual agents independently with domains in isolation, such as one for restaurant, air travel, movie, etc. These domains have common or overlapping attributes such as location, time, number of people, and so on. Intuitively, this information need not be meant multiple times pertaining to individual domain, and that a transfer is indeed desired and feasible. So basically, what are the contributions? So we have successfully combining the transfer learning and the hierarchical reinforcement learning framework. Okay, so we are successfully combining the transfer learning and the reinforcement learning framework to build multi-domain, multi-intent-based dialog system. The utility of transfer learning yields faster and better convergence of the dialog policy for the target domain compared to the ones trained independently. The proposed approach aims to reduce the data requirement to train multi-domain virtual agents significantly by leveraging from the transfer learning based approach. So basically, this is the new idea that we have the natural language understanding module, and now there is a switch between the dialog manager. So there is a source domain dialog management strategy, there is a destination domain dialog management strategy, and some intents are somehow common. So we need to map the intents of the source domain to the intents of the destination domain, and then have to copy the controller policies. So each intent is having its own controller policy, So we need to copy the controller policy of the source domain in the destination domain. That is the advantage of the transfer learning, that no need to train the destination domain again from the scratch. Rather, we can borrow the information, borrow the learning from the source domain. So this is the idea. You can see that user is giving uttering an utterance. Then there is this domain policy. So domain policy selects a particular, you know, what is the type of, what is the domain type, domain name. Depending on the domain name, it basically invokes a particular intent policy. Now intents are different, intent one, intent two, up to intent k. So they are here also, intents are different. So there is a source policy, source domain, and there is a target domain. So source domain is having its own set of intents. Target domain is having its own set of intents. And then basically, you know that there is this reward. So so basically there are, you know, each controller, each intent is having its own controller policy. So this controller policy can be copied into the destination domain. So if there will be a mapping from different intents of the source domain to the intents of a destination domain, and then the corresponding controller policy can be copied. So suppose intent one of the source domain maps to intent two of the destination domain, intent k of the source domain maps to intent n of the destination domain, then the corresponding controller policy can also be copied. So without transfer learning, the two domains are trained independently, where the weights of the network of each domain are initialized randomly, which produces dialog states from unique or distinct distributions. Also, the output space or the set of actions are as well independent of the other domains. We apply transfer learning from the source to the target domain only for the low-level controller policies, because VA interacts or elicits information from the user with the help of only the low-level controller policy. Rest of the higher-level meta policies help decompose the composite task into multiple subtasks in different granularities not known to the user. In order to leverage from transfer learning, it is essential to model the dialog state for both the source and target domains such that it came from the same or an identical distribution. While training the controller policy for the source side, the state of the dialog depends on must also incorporate not just the slots explicit to the source domain, but also those that are present in the target domain. So basically what we did, we basically somehow make the state inputs and outputs same. So this intent, suppose this intent maps to this intent of the, this is the source domain, this is the target domain. And source is having multiple intents, destination is having multiple intents. First, somehow semantically, we have to map each intent of the source domain to an intent of the destination domain. So suppose intent one of the source domain maps to intent one of the destination domain. Now, for the intent one of the source domain, there is a controller policy, but now we are making the state space similar. So the states of the intent one of the source domain and the intent one of the destination domain are merged together. And that would be the input of both the controller policies. Because if you want to copy the weights, then the inputs and the output should be the same. So if you want to copy the weights of this neural network into this neural network, then the inputs and the outputs, the topology should be the same. Merging the state space of the intent one of the source domain with the state space of the intent one of the destination domain, and then all the states are present in the input. Similarly, this intent is having a set of actions. This intent is having a set of actions. So actions are also, we also took the union of the actions. And then all the actions are present in the output of the neural network. So for example, here all the actions are present. Here also all the actions are present. So now while training the subnetworks or controller policies of the target domain, the weights of the neural networks are not initialized randomly. Rather, the weights of the chosen subnetwork of the source domain for both input and output space are copied to a subnetwork of the target domain. So now we are not initializing these weights randomly. Rather, we are copying the weights from here to here. Then the subnetwork pertaining to the target site is further trained to optimize and learn behavior specific to its subtask. So basically, this way we are applying the transfer learning. So transfer learning is applied to transfer the weight values of the controller policy from the source domain to the destination domain. So the destination domain is no longer initialized randomly, but it borrows the initial weights from the source domain. So then basically, firstly, we choose subnetworks or controller policies which are semantically similar or have significant overlapping slots with each other in between the source and target domain. For example, the encoding about the price of an entity such as restaurant or hotel semantically means the same thing. Secondly, even if the interests do not semantically represent a similar thing, we can still exploit the existence of similar slots in unrelated intents. So we experimented with the overlapping slots. Like there are three domains: air travel, restaurant, and the air travel, restaurant, the hotel information. You can see that restaurant and the hotel are very close domain, because many slots are common between the restaurant and the slots and the hotel. Budget, name, amenities, cuisine, rating, number of people, city. So these are the common slots between hotel and the restaurant. But air travel and the restaurant are very distant domain because they have very less number of slots. So these are some results. So these results illustrate that when we are using transfer learning, there is a faster convergence. So we are getting more success compared to the no transfer learning. So when we are transferring the weights, we are getting more success compared to when we are not transferring the weights. So this is another example which shows, you can see the blue lines are with transfer learning and the red lines are without transfer learning. And x-axis is the number of dialogues, y-axis is the success rate. So you can see the success rate is keep on increasing with the transfer learning. So this is that if we are using the transfer learning, then what is the without transfer learning, what is the number of dialogues, and with transfer learning, what is the number of dialogues. So you can see that case one is for the distant domain, case two is for the closed domain. And for the distant domain, you know, there is a reduction in the number of dialogues. Initially, without a hard transfer learning, it requires 4,809 dialogues, but now it only requires 3,700 dialogues. Similarly, for the closed domain, it requires, say, 7,830 dialogues, but now it requires 5,000 dialogues. So now, in the last one, what we did, so till now users were expressing input in terms of the text. So users were expressing input in that form of a text. So, but sometimes, you know, users often express input in terms of text and images both. So we want to develop a system where the user can easily understand the multimodal, the agent can easily understand the multimodal input given by the user. So suppose the user is conversing with the agent, and it is not always possible for the user to express everything in text. So in that case, the user can express something in the form of an image also. So that is basically called the multimodal. So learn a dialogue policy for multi-intent conversations using hierarchical reinforcement learning. VA should be capable of handling multimodal information from the user in terms of text and images. virtual agent should be capable of handling multimodal information from the user in terms of text and images. User behavior, apart from semantics, such as sentiment, provides complementary information to better understand users. VA should learn sentiment-aware dialogue policy. So basically, we learn a dialogue policy for multi-intent conversations using hierarchical reinforcement learning. VA should be capable of handling multimodal information from the user in terms of text and the images. User behavior, apart from semantics, such as sentiment, provides complementary information to better understand the users. So basically, now the motivation is twofold. One is that now our natural language understanding module should be capable of understanding not only text, but also the images. So we need to enhance our natural language understanding module so that it can easily understand the text as well as images. Secondly, the sentiment is used as a reward function. So basically, the target of the agent is to make the user happy. So at each level, after each utterance of the user, we can measure the user sentiment. And if the user sentiment becomes negative, then we can penalize the agent. So that is another contribution, that we try to use the sentiment as a reward function. We try to make the user happy. So that's why after a agent's question, user sentiment becomes negative, that means the agent is not picking the right actions. So the agent should be penalized more. So these are the two contributions. So in this work, we have extended the natural language understanding module to automatically interpret image and text both. And second is that sentiment is used as a reward function. Eventual evaluators and consumers of any dialogue system are users. They extract feedback from the user in terms of sentiment. Will steer the VA to be user adaptive, learn an efficient dialogue policy. In real-life conversations, users communicate their choices or queries using text, images, verbal communications. In task-oriented conversations, users take help of images to convey their preferences. Makes the entire communication easier for users and increases the scope of VAs in terms of utility, thus stressing the role of incorporating multimodal information. So basically, here there are three contributions. So first, we have used the hierarchical reinforcement learning based framework. Again, a hierarchical reinforcement learning framework is used, but now this DM is given two types of rewards. One is a task-based reward, which we have already discussed, and there is a sentiment-based reward. We also developed a data set because there was no such data set available where inputs are given in the form of image and text both. And our experimental results illustrate that this system is very much capable of, you know, this incorporation of the sentiment-based reward helps in convergence. So we use the Barbie data set for creating our own data set. But in Barbie, there was no images. So in some cases, we have replaced the text with the images. This VSCENTI VA dataset contains a total of 1 to 86 dialogue modified for the presence of multi-intents in a particular dialogue, annotated for its corresponding intent slot and sentiment levels, along with visual communication of user's choice of a specific entity through images. The dataset contains a total of 1,460 images of various slots and the types. So this is one example, like user is saying good morning, agent is saying hello, what can I help you with today? User is saying, I would like a table for two in London in a moderate price range. Agent is saying, I am on it. User is silent. Agent is saying, any preference on a type of cuisine? So now, instead of typing the answer, user is posting an image. And you know, from the image only, you can understand this is basically user is searching for a Chinese restaurant. Did you say Chinese restaurant? Agent is asking. User, obviously. What category restaurant are you looking for? Now user is not giving the answer, but user is posting an image. So it is 5-star. Okay, let me look into some options for you. Silence. AP calls Spanish London to moderate. Silence. What do you think of this option? Restore London, moderate Spanish, 6-star. No. So user, the user sentiment is negative. So user agent will automatically understand that the option shown is not correct for the user. No. Do you have it? Something else? Agent is saying sure. Let me find another option for you. Agent is saying silent. Agent, what do you think of this option? User is saying that looks great. Agent, great. Let me do the reservation. User is asking, do you have its phone number? Agent, here it is. Agent is saying here. User is saying, may I have the address of the restaurant? User is saying, here it is. User is saying, you rock. Is there anything I can help you with? User is saying, no, thank you. Agent is saying, you are welcome. So you can understand that now, in order to express the queries, users are not only writing in the text, but also posting some images. So that is the thing, that now there is an image identification module. From the image identification module, we need to extract the important information in the form of slots. So there is this intent classification slot filling, but now there are two additional information required: image identification and the sentiment classification. So image identification extracts important information from the image, which are called the slots. And the sentiment classification basically classifies the sentiment of the user utterance. Like, which restaurant can I book for two people for today? If this is the user input, first we extract the semantic space, and then we extract the useful information like date equal to today, number of people equal to two, and sentiment equal to neutral. Then there is this controller policies, high top level intent meta policy, low level controller policy. And then intent meta policy will invoke the controller policy. Then there will be this action. This is a DM, hierarchical DM. Hierarchical DM will basically select some action, and that action will be translated into user or system response for the natural language generation module. So now this is our multimodal state space. So now we have extended. So given the utterance, it passes through the CNN and then followed by a multilayer perceptron for the intent classification. It passes through a BILSTM for the slot identification. It again passes through a BILSTM for the sentiment classification. And then it passes through a ResNet for identification of the images, for extracting useful information from the images. So basically, this is the this intent slot sentiment and the image extracted information extracted from images that constitutes our state space. So this is the multimodal utterance semantic state space representation, and this state space is basically further used. So we have used the sentiment as a reward function, as I already mentioned. See, if the sentiment is positive, then we give a reward. If the sentiment is negative, we give a penalty. Otherwise, for the neutral, there is also a reward. So these are the results. So this curve show that with both types of sentiment, task oriented and the sentiment reward, task reward and the sentiment reward, there is a huge increase in the average reward. You can see the number of number of iterations versus the average reward. So you can see that the average reward is the highest for the BA with TR plus SR. So performance of BAs during testing, so user satisfaction is also improving. So with both types of rewards, like task oriented reward and sentiment based reward, the user is more satisfied. 87% of the times out of 100, the user is satisfied. For the average chance are also the lowest. So we know that TR plus SR multimodal approach is getting the lesser number of chance compared to the other models. This is an example output. Like, see, what do you think of this option? No, do you have something else? So now immediately agent understood that the user is not happy with the option. So user says, sure, let me find another option for you. Then agent is saying, what do you think of this option? So agent is showing the different option. But if the sentiment-based reward is not used, then say, you know, in the next example, this option is available. No, do you have something else? Now the agent is not able to understand that the user is not happy with the option because the sentiment-based reward is not there. It is still telling that, is there anything I help you with? No, I don't like that. So basically, this is a task-oriented reward. So there are some errors. So errors are coming mostly from the image identification module, because in the image identification module, identification module is not able to understand, is not able to separate between the seafood and the Chinese food. So if the user is interested in the seafood, but it is showing the image, so then, you know, it's very ambiguous problem. So the image classification module is giving some errors. So these are some publications out of this work, like this dialogue systems. We have published some papers. So these are the papers published in different journals and conferences out of this our dialogue systems work. So now, if you have any question.
Yes, Dinesh sir, you have one question you can ask now. Then we will go for other participants. Thank you, ma'am, for the nice and informative session.
Thank you.
Dinesh will take question from the Dinesh, then I will go ask my question. Yes, Mr. Dinesh. Ma'am, question of Dinesh is whether natural language generation means summarization. He has written in chat box. Whether natural language generation means summarization is the question.
No. Natural language generation is different. Natural language generation means generating the response, like what the agent will tell. So like you can see this here, the agent is saying, is there anything I can help you with? So this is the natural language generation. This is not the summarization. So depending on the user's query, and the past history, the module, this natural language generation module, has to generate a response. So it is not a summarization, but this is not the natural language generation, because we are generating a sentence in the natural language. So this sentence construction depends on the user's utterance, what user has asked for, and also the past history. So this past history or the context is stored in the form of a state space. So in the state space, we have all the information stored, and we have the previous utterance, and now we can generate a new utterance. So it is not different. It is not similar to the summarization.
Okay, and next question, ma'am, from Ankur. Ankur sir wants to ask some question from BIT Mestra. Yes, Ankur.
Yeah. Hello, is it audible?
Yes.
Yes.
Actually, I want to ask that these all things, how can we proceed with low resource language if we have a low resource language, okay, resource poor language?
Yeah, yes. Okay, so.
Same question from my side also. I want to develop same chat box in Odia language. Then I will extend it to multilingual Indian languages. So from where we'll start?
So basically,
labeled data. Sorry.
So the first point is that is dialogue manager. So dialogue manager learns the mapping between state space and the action. So here there is no role of language. So we have shown in our works that this is independent of the language. The dialogue manager is independent of the language. But the natural language understanding modules depends on the language. So for that, we are also developing some data sets like ATIS, Swissboard. These data sets are available in English. Similarly, you need to translate those data sets into the original languages and then manually check those languages. So basically, we used to use the Google Translator to translate the English into the regional languages and then manually check those translations, because Google translation accuracy is not high.
Okay, ma'am. If that language is not available on the Google Translator, then what we will do?
Yeah, then you have to manually do. You have to manually translate. You have to employ some annotators to manually translate the data. But this dialogue manager is independent of language, okay? Because this is a reinforcement learning based agent. There is no role of language. It basically maps the state into action.
Okay. It's a generalized approach, okay? Then.
Yeah, it is a generalized approach, yes.
Okay. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Again, thank you for this informative session. And I will send you the slide to all participants once I'll get from ma'am. Sam, ma'am, thank you very much. Yeah, definitely, I'll be in contact with you.
Thank you. Sure. Thank you. Thanks. Yes. I'm leaving. Yeah, thanks.